Greetings all. Welcome back to another session here of Tuzi Talks. Today we're going to be continuing our discussion in language assessment in the ESL classroom. In particular today, we're going to be talking about assessing speaking. And just to let you know that a lot of this information comes from this textbook right over here, Language Assessment Principles and Classroom Practices by Brown and Priyanvada. So if you wanted to get that book, you can certainly go check it out or ask me a little bit more about it. We're going to go on here and talk about assessing speaking. Of all the skills that you're going to be assessing as a language teacher, this is probably the one that's the most prominent, especially if you're dealing in the business world. Speaking and writing are going to be the most prominent. Speaking, of course, is very important because what happens to people when you first greet with them, normally it is an oral interaction. And as they say, the first impression does make an impact on people. So we want to be able to assess students' speaking abilities so that they sound more like a native speaker. I remember years ago I was listening to a missionary who was a missionary in Africa. And I forget where, I believe it was Tanzania. He spoke about one day he was driving his vehicle and something happened to it and it wasn't working. And he had to go to find some house. And he went to the house and he knocked on the door and they said, "Who is it?" And he said, "Well, it's me." And the reason why he said, "It's me," is because that was the custom of the language that he was using. And nobody came to the door. He followed a particular custom. Normally, in an American U.S. culture, you would give your name. You know, "I'm so-and-so, I had a problem." But in the culture he was in, it was just, "It's me." And nobody came to the door. He did it a couple times, and finally, you know, someone came to the door, and they opened the door, and immediately they realized, "Oh, this person is a foreigner." And they apologized. "Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't realize. I thought you were a native of the land." Now, this guy who was a missionary, he was kind of glad. He spoke in such a way that people didn't realize that he was a foreigner. It's a really nice feeling to be able to do that. When I was living overseas and I would get a phone call, I could pick up the phone and I could speak, and at least for the first couple of seconds, nobody knew I was a foreigner. That was a great feeling. I, of course, would then start making grammar mistakes, and the people at the other end would be like, okay, something is up. But my pronunciation was in such a way that I appeared to be a native speaker. Always a good feeling when you have that. So one of the reasons why we want to assess speaking is because of the impression that it makes when you hear someone speak with an accent. It also makes it easier for people to understand what you're saying, because there are a lot of people, especially in the United States, who are not used to speaking and working with people with different languages or from a different language, and listening to people's accents can be very difficult for them. So we want native speakers to be able to understand these second language learners. We want second language learners to sound as if they were born and raised here. Certainly can be done, and that's something that we should try to achieve as we're trying to train people. We want to assess their speaking skills so they can sound like a native speaker. Some speaking preliminaries. One thing that we need to remember is that speaking cannot be assessed without listening. Speaking is a productive skill, but normally you cannot produce without having something going in first. You can't answer a question, right, without getting some type of listening as well. So speaking, generally speaking, cannot be assessed without listening. Assessing speaking is always done through the filter of something else, because you're getting them to respond to something. They got to know before they can respond. Of course, the primary challenge of here is eliciting the desired response. How do we get these students to say what we want them to say? And that's part of the process. That's actually the mental processes going on, but also the production of the sounds that they need to make. So just like before, when we were speaking about listening, we've got different skill levels that we can be talking about. We can talk about micro skills that they need to learn to say, produce, and also the more macro skills. Micro skills deal, again, with the sounds, the creation of sounds, the creation of those letters and chunks and word classes, and to be able to do stress, to be able to create reduced forms. Just a little quick thing on reduced forms. I always enjoy going to my students, and when I say to them, you know, I write up on the board, what is your name? And then they repeat it, what is your name? I said, no, that's not how it's spoken. That's how it's written, but it's not how it's spoken. And then I would write up on the board, what's your name? What's your name? And they didn't know what it meant. Or I would say to them, what are you doing? I'd write that up on the board, but then when you do it in phonetics, it would be, whatcha doing? Whatcha doing? What, or wada ya doing? And they couldn't read it. They didn't realize that the pronunciation wasn't the same. Some languages, there's a great close relationship between the written word and the spoken word. Other languages, like English, like French, there's a greater disconnect between them. So teaching them how to do those things, those micro things, is going to be a definite plus as well. But there are more than just the micro things. There are the macro things. For example, again, language functions that you can be focusing on. You can focus on style, different ways that people say and do certain functions in language. So how many different ways can you say hello, how are you, hi, what's up? You know, a lot of different things that you can do with regard to style. Register would be another. Different ways that you speak to someone, whether he's, you know, a governor of the state, or he's the president of a company, or he's the guy who delivers your mail. Whether he's a family, or whether he's, the priest in the local church. You'd have different ways of speaking to all these different people. So register is definitely something that you could be testing. You can also get them to try to explain meaning, imply meaning, whether they can do literal or non-literal words and phrases in the language. Can they make jokes appropriately? Can they speak in metaphorical terms? All these different things that you can be testing. Can they perform strategies for speaking? My favorite one being circumlocution. Can they speak around a word they don't know in order to get you to elicit that word? So we've got micro skills and then macro skills that we can do. At the lower level, we're going to be dealing with imitation or intensive type of speaking activities. These are activities where students, where you're focusing on the minor, the small, the easier to complete types of activities. When you're designing speaking tests, obviously you can do a homemade activities like the ones that we're going to be looking at mostly throughout here. Whether they are, you know, the imitative or the intensive or the ones that we're going to be seeing later, we can have homemade ones. You know, just for example is the repeat after me. Okay, or as I mentioned before, shadowing, where all through class your students are simply repeating what you say, or repeat after me. Types of activities. Okay, they're easy to imitate, and that's the homemade version. You could also do things like read aloud tasks or oral questionnaires. Those are all homemade types of things that you can do, but you can also go out and buy them. One type of oral assessment tool is this test called Versant, and Versant is a great tool that you can purchase, and it's a Pearson tool, but it will allow you to test a whole bunch of people all at the same time from a phone or from a computer, and they're relatively accurate, so I would definitely recommend them, provided that the price is not too cost prohibitive. That's Versant. It doesn't take long to do the test, and really one of the problems with giving out speaking assessments is the time that it takes. So something like that is, it's automated, it's done by the computer, it's very accurate, and so it's going to be very easy to implement. Again, provided that the cost is not too prohibitive. So we have imitative types tests where we, again, I already said, repeat after me type of things, or shadowing. You also have intensive speaking, where students have a limited response. They only have to say a certain thing. So, for example, a minimal type of a conversation where everything is kind of formulaic, you can do something like that. You can test grammatical forms, where you have a sentence and you change one form, and then of course it forces other things to change. Like, I am reading a book. Okay, we change I to he. He is reading a book. Change he to they. They are reading a book. And so they're going to be speaking those things, but they're also going to be learning some of the grammatical forms that go with them. Make sure that they are meaningful in conversation. Read aloud tasks where you're simply reading. Okay, and you read the same thing over and over again. This is a reliable type of an assessment because they're seeing whether they can read one thing, but you're seeing also the same thing over and over again. And so that's going to be more reliable. It's probably going to be less authentic because it's not impromptu speech. There's a playoff there. Which one do you want to do? An oral questionnaire where you're asking them questions and they have to provide you with answers. Sometimes when I do oral questionnaires, I get students who give me one-word answers. And I need to let them know, no, you need to speak in a full sentence because I'm assessing you. My favorite story there is I asked this student, I said, well, what did you do this weekend? And their answer was one word, shopping. I said, no, you can't just say one word. You've got to give me, we went to, you know, this store and I bought, you know, whatever, to get them to help them to practice, but also to assess their language ability. So oral questionnaires. Another thing you can do is use pictures. I love using pictures. If you have a bank of pictures, like on cards or whatever, or on a slide you can use on the computer, it's a great tool to have because you can use it to test their comprehension. You can use it to test their speaking of those particular words, but you can also get them to tell a story. So you can get them to talk about the fluency. You can also use maps and the like. So here, for example, is a picture. And you can then say, you can ask specific questions. What's he doing? What's she doing? But you can also ask more general questions. What's going on? Where is this? What's happening? And, you know, or tell them to make up a story with what's going on in these pictures. So there's a bunch of different things that you can be doing with pictures like this. And there are a lot of pictures around that have these types of things. Here's another one. This is by BrainPop online. You can tell because of this guy right here. I forget his name, but he's the computer character. But you can be asking questions or asking individual type questions or larger group type questions. So that would be using maps and the like, looking at fluency. As you move up the scale to larger types of conversations, you can have responsive speaking. And these are going to be not the short, stock answers that you have, but there's going to have greater interaction and greater response than the short, intensive answers. These are types of questions where you, the assessor, you ask a question and then you sit back and wait and you let them talk. You want to let them know that you're keeping interest, but you want them to be able to take the lead a little bit longer. May begin with a simple question, or it might go into a series of questions. But they're often open-ended types of questions. They might be giving instructions. You want something that's a little more intense than something more basic. It could be paraphrasing. You know, they read a book, and then you want me to tell me what this book was about. Type of thing, or they read an article or saw a movie, that type of a thing. But it's responsive, but it's going to be a little larger than just those short answers that we saw before, responsive speaking. The authors of the book that we're looking at talked about the test of spoken English. This test no longer exists. It has been subsumed into the TOEFL test. And so it is now a part of the TOEFL test, so I'm not even going to go into this. But there are other types of spoken tests out there, like I showed you before, where students, or you can use that to test students. It's good to have a test like this just to get some type of a proficiency mark on their speaking ability. But the test of spoken English no longer is being offered because it has now been subsumed into the TOEFL. Interactive speaking. Again, we're moving higher up now. We're going to have people giving longer bouts of conversation. These tasks require a long stretches of discussions and are typically more interpersonal in nature. So it's going to be an issue or a problem or something that has related to the learner, and they'll be able to delve into greater detail with the conversation. could also be doing interviews at this level. And this list right here, the warm-up level check probes and wind-down, they actually come from the ACTFL oral proficiency interview, which we had talked about before. But you could easily be doing that as far as a way to test your students and to see their language abilities. I would recommend that you do come over here and take a look at ACTFL and look at their standards. If you just click over here on their English standards, you see that they've got standards for a variety of areas. You'll note that the areas they do have, they have about 5 different levels, and the most famous of which is the speaking standard. And as you look at this, you'll see that they've got 5 levels: distinguished, superior, advanced, intermediate, and novice. And they actually break them down even into smaller ones. But you can come here and you can look and see at the different descriptions that these are. A distinguished speaker is basically someone who's good in all areas. A superior speaker, they can communicate accurately and with fluency. They sometimes run into problems, okay? And there's some examples that you can look at if you want. And then we have advanced, and they can do much, okay? But they still, what does it say? They are consistently able to explain detail and narrate fully and accurately in all time frames. So they're not going to have much problem with grammar, even at this level. They are going to have other issues. Look at this. They use precise vocabulary and intonation to express ideas. All right, so this is at the advanced high. You can see how you can use this information to help you assess your students to see where they would fit. Now, obviously, you're not an OPI rater. You don't have the permission to say that you're giving an actual ACTFL interview. But they've given you all those guidelines, and you can use them to assess your students. You can also do role plays and play games with the students at this level. And a role play, there is no dialogue necessarily. They have to make it up as they go. And there are games that do similar types of things where they have to initiate and create on the fly. It's definitely higher level English speaking. With extensive speaking, it's going to be similar to the interactive, except that they're going to do a lot more of their own speaking. These are things like oral presentations or storytelling. In this case, there's not a lot of interaction with other people. It's still long, but it's just more of a monologue. It's more of you being up there by yourself. So again, we've gone from little to big. We've gone from the micro level things all the way up to the macro, the extensive speaking. These are all the different ways that you can assess speaking. I know I've kind of covered these rather quickly. You can certainly go in and look in more detail at some of the things that are here, but I did want to give you this brief overview. I do thank you for stopping by. If you have any questions, you can shoot an email downstairs, or you can send me just a regular email. Talk to you later now. Bye-bye.